You may notice that the music books are no longer in the pews. If you haven't found the wrong tablet, you can go to the newswire and click on the link for the music for today. We also have a few hard copies available if needed. If you need hard copies, please raise your hand and an usher will bring you copies. We are distributing communion differently than we have in the past. You will notice that we will have individual cups with Eucharistic bread and wine on tables in the front of the altar. At communion, you will be invited to come forward and take a cup with the bread and a cup with the wine. We ask that you practice proper social distancing as you come forward. You will notice that we have markings on the floor to assist you. There will be a receptacle for you to deposit the cups as you move to the right. Before we begin our liturgy, let us pause briefly to gather ourselves in the presence of the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
God, the Father of mercies, through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you have reconciled the world to yourself and brought the Holy Spirit among us for the forgiveness of sins. Through the ministry of the Church, may God grant you pardon and peace, and I absolve you of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Not return there until they have watered the earth,
may it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the one who eats. So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I propose and succeed in the things for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption to sonship and the redemption of our bodies. The word of the Lord.
Never understand, and you will indeed look, but never seed. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes, so that they might not look with their eyes, and listen with their ears, and understand in their heart, and turn. And I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see. And blessed are your ears, for they hear. Truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root and endures only a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of that word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Deepen the Jewish understanding of the word of God. not being a spoken word alone, but an event of divine intervention. Prophets like Isaiah taught that the word of God means the Lord's all-powerful and dynamic intervention and presence in history. In creation and among God's people, they taught, prophets taught, that words produce the reality that they represent. In Genesis and creation, we hear God speaks words, and then things are made. So as we heard in the first reading today from 2 Isaiah, God's word poured out on the earth brings about the will of God. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. God's word is God's will made manifest, and it produces abundant fruit. God's word is a seed that manifests great abundance. The prophets assure us, the people and us, that no matter how tough or helpless or hopeless somebody feels, God is at work in our circumstances, bringing divine plans to manifestation. The gospel today unfolds for us in three parts. Parable of the sower, as Jesus teaches us more about the meaning of the word of God, compares the word of God to seeds. Then we hear an explanation of why Jesus teaches in parables, and then we hear Jesus himself privately interpreting the parable of the sower to the apostles. Why does Jesus teach us in parables? To explain the mysteries of faith in language that could be understood by people listening, Jesus used parables and simple stories to illustrate spiritual lessons. Jesus tells us in today's gospel that the level of faith understanding among the people listening is not as developed as those of the apostles. For this people's heart has grown dull. And in biblical language, the heart referred really to the mind. But Jesus was saying, their minds are sluggish. This is a willful obstinance of not recognizing the presence of God and the divine work being alive in their lives. Their spiritual senses are not being used. Jesus is referring to their ears being hard of hearing and their eyes being shut. He's referring to their refusal to use their spiritual senses, their spiritual parts, ears and eyes, which has resulted in having little spiritual perception. You don't use your spiritual parts, ears and eyes, your spiritual senses, you're not going to have much spiritual perception. But what do you think Jesus means when he says, to anyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich? From anyone who has not, even what he has will be taken away. What do you think he means by that? Anyone who has what? Anyone who has faith. Anyone who has an authentic faith based on applying the spiritual senses and maturity of faith will grow rich, because faith is luxury. Faith is luxury on women. That person will grow rich. Anyone who has not is anyone who has no faith. Even what that person has will be taken away. In other words, unless a person seeks to grow in faith understanding, even what little faith that person may have begun with will certainly wither away. If we do not apply ourselves in faith to being disciples of Christ, we will not inherit the kingdom, and we will not help to make the kingdom manifest in our lifetime. So when in the parable of the sower, Jesus refers to people who hear the word of God but do not understand it, he means people who willfully refuse to apply themselves to faith. People whose faith is shallow are vulnerable to losing their true sense of self. They are vulnerable to disconnecting from their own souls. They do not respond to the divine presence at work in their lives. They cannot see God's presence at work in Jesus. It is wonderful to hear Jesus himself interpret the parable of the sower. We hear that the word of God spread like the farmer's seeds, sown on all types of terrain. 75% of the time, it doesn't take root. Most of the possibility of God that comes with the word of God is not received. However, the harvest coming from the small neighbor, the faithful remnant, where the word of God has taken root, is a fantastic level of abundance. So for followers of Christ, the parable of the sower ultimately points to one question. Don't worry about the seeds. That's God. That's God sending his presence, his word, and spiritual presence. We worry about being the good soil. Our question, our call by this gospel is to be good soil, to have a place for God's word to take root and manifest abundance in good soil. As good soil, we magnify the presence of God's word as Mary did. As good soil, we are called to peacefully endure persecution when called upon by bringing gospel values to the world. As good soil, we resist the evil of violence and racist divisions among people. As good soil, we cannot let the lures of the world, of the materialism that we combat every day, the many temptations to power and endless distractions in this culture that take us away from ourselves. We are spiritual beings. Jesus told the parable of the sower to remind us of our responsibility to be good soil, receptive to God's grace and presence, and active in our world. The word of God is an active presence in the world. It is not enough to just say the words of faith, because the word of God is not just a spoken word. The word of God is God's will, God's presence, and God's action, manifesting our redemption. So let us be willing and good soil, so the word of God takes root deeply within us. Let's pray that as good soil, we may be more fully able to answer Christ's call to manifest the kingdom in abundance. And may God bless you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
May the spirit of our patron, St. Charles of Brazil, guide the Catholic Apostolic Church in North America to heed Jesus' call to help the poor, outcast, and rejected in society. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Together we can make a difference. When we seek a world where economic practices create well-being for all stakeholders, including communities and the environment. In faith, we pray. For a healing of racism, that all people look upon one another as sisters and brothers and work for peace in the world, trusting that God will heal long-standing injuries and guide enemies to a new understanding. In faith, we pray. For all who are ill, that they may know the tender touch of God through the prayer and care of this community. In faith, we pray. For those who have died, that they will receive their eternal inheritance. In faith we pray. For whom we also wish to pray this morning, we will hear all the prayers that you wish to share, and then we will offer our response.
God, you have called us to proclaim your healing power and mercy. Hear ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It's right to
give God thanks and praise. All powerful and ever living God, we dwell always and everywhere to give you thanks. So great was your love that you gave us your Son as our Redeemer. You sent him as one like ourselves, though free from sin, that you might see and love in us what you see and love in Christ. Your gift of grace lost by disobedience are now restored by the obedience of your Son. We praise you, Lord, with all the angels and the saints in their song of joy. Of my blood, the blood of the new and the everlasting covenant. and love with thine all her children wherever they may be. Welcome into your kingdom on the part of brothers and sisters, especially Carol Ann Bristow, and all who have left this world in your friendship. We hope to enjoy forever the vision of your glory through Christ our Lord, from whom all good things come.
Oh. Mm-hmm.